Welcome back to the Epoch Podcast. My name is Ben Worski, and with me as always is my host, Diego Bryan.
Hello, hello.
Today we have another guest who we're bringing back from episode number 4. He's our most requested guest to come back, and he's the only podcast that I recommend to my family, Neil Peterson.
For the record, that I requested myself to come back.
So, Neil is joining us. If you don't remember, Neil hails us from Athens, Georgia, although he lives here, but he goes to school in Georgia, and he just came back from the Liberty Bell Bowl game?
Liberty Bowl. Liberty Bowl. Yeah, Zone Liberty Bowl.
Wow. So tell us how that was. That seemed Georgia won. First off, let's start with that. So that makes it a lot better.
Yeah.
You played TCU?
We played TCU.
Okay.
So it was cool. We were in Memphis, which was a cool city.
Where did you stay at? Sorry.
We stayed at the Peabody Hotel, where it was like this like super old hotel that had like, they're famous for ducks, which is weird.
yeah, that's a weird thing to be famous for.
And my mom told me that, and I was like, okay, sure. But they have these ducks that swim in a fountain in the middle of the lobby.
And
at 11 a.m., they march from the elevator to the fountain. They swim in the fountain until 5 p.m. And at 5 p.m., it's like a big ceremony when
they're
trained ducks. And they have a duck master. It's like 83 years they've been doing this tradition. And he has like a cane with a duck on it. He's like dressed up like a British soldier from the Revolution. And then they march back on the elevator. They go to the roof of the hotel. And they have a palace. Literally, it's called the Duck Palace. That's where they stay. And it's like, that's what they're known for. So it was kind of weird, honestly. People like line up at like 40 minutes before. But one of the really funny things is you're not allowed to stand up while they're doing this because it might scare the ducks.
Okay, so you have to sit. Everybody's sitting on the floor,
sitting in chairs, or like
army crawling to move.
Like looking down in the balcony, which is where we were. But the day before we went to watch this duck ceremony, our head coach, Kirby Smart, who was defensive coordinator at Alabama, but his coaching career was like Nick Saban. The dude is awesome. Amazing coach, right?
Are you like friends with him?
No, not really.
The question is, can we get him on the pod?
He's like very business. Like he lives, sleeps, breathes, everything football.
Yeah, makes sense. I think head coaches are usually like that.
Genius about it too.
Okay.
But so he's like all work, you know, like that. And so he was sitting on the ground with his kids watching this duck ceremony, like crisscross applesauce. And it honestly was like one of the like coolest things to see, because I was like, oh, okay, that's the head coach. Oh my gosh, that's Kirby Smart.
He's not a robot.
We're like, oh, that's awesome. But he was Alabama's defensive coordinator, and then he came and took the head coaching job, which is also cool because he was played, I think he was a cornerback. He was a defensive back for Georgia.
Really?
In the 90s. And so he is like kind of like his homecoming this season.
Unfortunately, it didn't turn out exactly the way that he wanted.
Yeah.
Your preseason expectations were higher, I believe.
Yeah, so we went, including the bowl game, we went 8-5. Which I guess by Georgia standards, I guess by most standards, it's not, you know, not what we wanted, but What is really exciting is that our recruiting, I was telling Ben about this on the way up, our recruiting class was number 3 in the country as of like 2 days ago. And I'm going to look up some of like the specifics, but there's something called flip season, which is where they take a lot of the recruits that have already had verbal commits somewhere, and they take, they get them to flip and commit to Georgia.
You guys were good at flip season?
We flipped, I think, like 3 players yesterday.
Holy cow.
And we jumped to 2. So we got a 5-star that jumped to, or we got a 5-star named D'Angelo Gibbs. He's a defensive back that he committed to Georgia. And this was at the All-American, Under Armour All-American game.
Right.
And then we got like another inside linebacker that was from LSU. And then we got like a 4-star defensive back again, like a wide receiver, something like that. And so since we've like jumped to 2, and we're like 1 away from beating Alabama for the number 1 spot, which is, I think, a really big deal.
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, Alabama just has a dynasty.
Yeah, and like, I mean, it's just crazy. To me, that says a lot about Kirby Smart as head coach. Like, he's been here for 1 year, and like this year he was dealing with, you know, when Kirby Smart got to Georgia, it wasn't as much about what kind of people can I recruit. It's about like,
who can I keep
that Mark Richt recruited,
right?
Who can I keep at Georgia? And so now, like, this next year is finally like Kirby Smart's year of recruiting and like finally taking control of the program, which I think is super exciting. We just had an offensive tackle sign, or not sign, who committed. His name, he's a 5-star, and his name is Isaiah Wilson.
Okay.
And he's like 6'8 or something like that, and he's like 355. Or 6'7, 355.
Jeez.
He's a huge person. He's 2 years younger than I am. And
he can eat you also.
I mean, it's just like really exciting to get, you know, big recruits like that. So yeah, I mean,
how much of a role do you think your videos play in the recruiting process?
100%, especially for the offensive line. You recruit 12 offensive linemen by himself.
It really is a lot about like the coaches, and we have a really great recruiting, like on campus recruiting. So there's something called Rose Society, and they kind of show players around during, you know, recruiting, and we have a really great on campus recruiting coordinator, and like, our coaches do a really good job of doing home visits and things like that.
Right. Do you guys do a good job of getting the in-state recruits?
Yeah, so that's where our main... Georgia, for some reason, I don't know what that reason is a hub for really good football players. Like, unbelievably. I think it's probably one of the best states, I think, other than Florida, for recruits. And so that's a big draw, is kind of like staying home and like representing your home state.
Because you're like one of the only... You're like... There's Georgia, Georgia Southern's another college. Yeah. Is there any, like, you're so, the only university, though, that's, like,
Georgia
big,
Tech.
Right?
Georgia Tech.
Yeah. I feel like people would, that's like, the next biggest, yeah.
Yeah, is the, like, the other team that people would want to go to. But Tennessee is not that far away from Georgia, so Tennessee also has a draw. South Carolina is not that far away. And Alabama's not that far away. You know, so you're kind of got, like, that. And with that is, like, Auburn is there, too. So, you know... Keeping them home, like in their home state, is a big deal, but it's especially a big deal when all of those big SEC schools are like not that far away when you think about it.
Right.
I think the drive to Tuscaloosa from Athens is like 4 or 5 hours.
Oh, that's not bad at all.
So, yeah, it's, you know, I don't know, it's marginal when you think about like guys going to like Michigan, you know what I mean? Like something like that.
Right.
But yeah, so I don't know. I think that's like one of the big things about it. And we have like, our graphics department is in recruiting, and we have a guy who does full-time video with Frank and I, but he's also in recruiting, and his videos and their graphics that they make are amazing.
This is the black guy? His name is Black, right?
Eric Black.
Yeah. Okay. I
understand
how that came out wrong. But, I remember his first name.
Just like the graphics that people will make, so like, you know, they'll send out...
do they make graphics with like the high school players wearing like Georgia's things?
They'll like Photoshop the like the Georgia.
That's really
like,
cool.
Breaking through their high school uniform.
That's so
their
cool.
High school uniform's like ripping or like burning up, and there's a Georgia uniform underneath it, or like, you know, I don't know. It's just like little things like that.
Right.
I don't know.
No, I think those definitely go
a
long way.
I see. I don't really see kind of like the sit down conversations that the coaches have that I know probably has a lot more than. You know, graphics, but like, it's like those little attention to detail. I think
people like posting stuff on the ground. So if you give them like 10 images that they can post over the course of a couple of weeks.
And I think it's like another thing is like we've gotten recruits to get really excited about coming to Georgia. So the recruits have been really good recruiters.
Right. Because all the recruits, I mean, I'm assuming this is the same with every sport. All the like upper echelon athletes, they're all stick together. So if they're like,
they're all buddies,
hey, where
from
like, where are you going? And then like, oh, I'm going to Georgia. They're like, you should also come with me. We
Nike,
can still
like,
hang.
Exactly. Like we can hang, like think about the program we could build, like, you know, it's that kind of thing. So we have a lot of really good young talent. So as every Georgia fan says, like, I'm excited for next year, but legitimately more so than our strength and conditioning coach, Coach Sinclair, is like, I think arguably one of the best in the country.
Yeah, I remember you telling us this last
time. He is like unbelievably good.
And your team was pretty young this year too, right?
Yeah,
we were really they have some experience on their back now. And
so we have like one guy has declared early, so that's all. We have one guy who's a junior who he's our slot receiver.
Was he expected
Isaiah
to go?
McKenzie. He wasn't expected to go, I don't think, but no one's really surprised that he did go.
Okay.
And I think he'll get drafted. He's small. I think he'd be like the next, now I'm blanking on his name.
What team?
Slot receiver for the Patriots.
Edelman.
Gronkowski.
Gronkowski. you know, like he'd be like a good like slot receiver. He's really quick. He's got good hands. He's insanely fast. He's like tied the record for most punt return touchdowns at Georgia. Or I think he beat the record.
I saw that video you guys made.
The human joystick. That's his name.
Really? That's cool.
So yeah, so he is going, and then we've got a lot of seniors but we've got a couple seniors leaving. But a lot of like our young, really good talent is staying, which is really great. So we've got
Chubb's coming back.
So Nick Chubb and Sonny Michel are both staying, which is unbelievable because arguably, I think pound for pound, Nick Chubb is the best running back in the country. And I think once he gets like, you know, the offensive line and everything kind of comes together, like he'll go off. But that's a really big.
He was injured this year? Who was injured?
He was injured last year.
Anyone injured this year?
No. Sonny Michel was injured at the beginning of the year. He broke his arm in an ATV accident. But he was healthy. He broke it on July 4th. So he was pretty healthy back by the time the season came around. But he's also staying.
And how good of a friends are you with these players now? Are you like tight? You like dap them up? You're like, what's up, Neil?
So,
let's hang out later. Get pizza or something.
So I'm not. Like, I know them. I'm not like, hey, let's be best friends and play Madden tonight. You know what I mean?
Right.
But I'm really good friends with a couple guys on the team. One guy named is Quincy Mojay, who's a defensive back, who's like an incredibly good photographer, which is really cool. And
so we should get him on the pod?
Yeah, if you want to look him up on Instagram, it's Qdawg Productions, Qdawg Productions. A little shout out. But yeah, dude is like incredibly good football player. I think he's going to go in the NFL draft for sure.
That's cool.
But also, like, if he doesn't, like, he's so talented in, like, all sorts of media stuff. But then another guy that I'm really good friends with who kind of made headlines this year was Maurice Smith, who was a defensive back at Alabama for 3 years and wasn't getting the playing time he wanted. And so his mom sent an email, and he was interested in transferring to Georgia. He was going to be a starter his senior year at Bama. He was on the ones.
Right.
But he wanted to be with Kirby Smart, I think, or something like that. Okay. I still don't know the full story. But
you got
he wanted
him.
To transfer to Bama, and Bama blocked his transfer.
That's right. Yes, I remember
and
this.
And so then the team took all of his stuff out of his locker and threw it in the trash, which included, like, a picture of his friend who had, like, you know, passed away when he was younger. Like, you know, like, all this stuff. And they wouldn't let him, like, work out with the team. They wouldn't let him, like, eat in the dining hall. But they also wouldn't let him transfer. So it turned into this, like, big fiasco. And finally, they let him go, like, 2 weeks before the season started. And he came to Georgia. And he's, like, you know, was unreal. And was a starter. Was a season-long captain. I definitely think he's going to go to the league. But, like, he and I have gotten really close. So it's funny. He was, like, oh, yeah, you know, if I ever go to the league, I want to take you, like, with me, and I'll fly you out and be my photographer or whatever. And
what?
Like, please.
You know, I think you should think about declaring this year.
Yeah, I was like, Mo, if you're listening to this, I hope that offer still stands. No, but he's just like a really, they're all really nice, like down to earth guys. But I wouldn't say I'm close enough to be like, let's hang out and play Madden later. Like, on Bowl Trip, I played FIFA with Quincy, and I beat him, by the way, in penalty kicks, for the record. But yeah, no, but they're all really nice guys. And if you kind of think about, like, what they're juggling, it's, like, insane how they can kind of, I don't know, manage all that. But
I mean, football players are just crazy.
Yeah, everyone's like, oh, you know, like, they should be able to manage it. Like, they're getting their, you know, academics paid for or whatever. And I'm like, you know, man, if you think about the money they're bringing in for this university, like, it's like four times the amount that their scholarship is worth. Like,
oh, yeah.
Especially if you're at, like, a bigger school. If you're like SEC, like Alabama, those players.
Oh, my gosh.
It's like they're in a professional program, but they're not getting paid.
The hours that they put into that is unreal. Like, you know, like, they have set hours of, like, when they watch film, but then, like, after practice ends, they just go back and they watch more film.
So, how do you feel about, like, players skipping bowl games? Like, Christian McCaffrey.
Leonard Fournette.
I'm not the biggest fan of that. I think, like, the deal is when you sign up to play for a team is that you sign up to play with that team in all the games that you can. And I think it's not really, like, I feel like it's kind of like a loophole, which it is. And like, I understand, like, you don't want to get hurt in a game that doesn't really matter, but I think it more says, like, it kind of shows your true character of what your intentions were, like, all 4 years or 3 years of college were just right. to get to the NFL rather than to, like, be
a part of the team. Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I'm not a huge fan of that. I think it also kind of makes it more of, like, a professional sport. You know what I mean? Like, where they're kind of choosing to sit out and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I think for the superstars, I feel like it's less because, like, they're definitely going to get drafted. But I think it's more of, like, a domino effect where it's, like, these mid-tier players who probably – they might not get drafted. And they're going to just be like, yeah, I'm also going to sit out. And then all of a sudden
– nobody's playing in the ball game.
And then it's going to extend, like, players are going to be like, all right, game five of the season, you know what? I feel like I've helped my draft stock enough.
Exactly.
I'm going to sit out the rest of the season.
It's kind of a precedent that it sets. But at the same time, like, I can understand – like, I'm, like, conflicted on it. I'm not, like, this is – oh, wow, I sound like it's, like, eating me up. It's,
yeah.
Like, I don't care that much. But, if you think about it, like, you know, Nick Chubb, I mean, the dude is, like, an anomaly because he, like, bounced back from that injury. But, like, it really only takes one play and your entire career is done. You know what
right,
I mean?
Right,
like,
yeah.
You know, like, Todd Gurley, like, tore his ACL. Like, you know, the dude went off again. But, like, you know, if he didn't come back from that, he had, like, millions of dollars that he could have, you know, signed with an NFL team. You know, if you think
right,
about like a Fournette, Christian McCaffrey, they've got, you know, millions waiting for them, and they take that risk of getting injured during the, like, whatever bowl game they play in and losing all of that. Like, I can understand the precaution.
I don't know. It's a huge risk, in my opinion. It's
but
a huge risk.
At the same time, it's like, that's kind of what you signed up for. You know what I mean?
That's just football.
Like, it's football. Yeah. Like, every time you step on the field, that's what you're kind of risking. But
I mean, yeah. I just feel like someone like Christian McCaffrey, he's made Stanford millions of dollars, like him alone,
he's
so much money that he's brought into Stanford, and it's like, it's like how much left? How much more does he owe you guys?
Well, Leonard Fournette. Well, the thing about Leonard Fournette is Leonard Fournette did that when they were playing like Florida,
right?
You know what I mean? Like he like would sit out games like in the regular season.
Well, he was injured this year, so I think I think that makes more sense to me than Christian.
Yeah,
because it's like it's not even like he played the whole season. He played like five games, still projected to go number one, just because he's a.
It was interesting. You know, it's kind of funny the waves that people declaring and not declaring have, because like I think Nick and Sony decided to stay just because of like the way that this draft is shaping up to be, and I think like they want, you know, they're definitely team leaders. But it's funny by them not going, then we lost a 4 or 5 star running back commit because if you think about
right.
it, we have. Nick, Sony, and then this guy named Brian Herring, his freshman, who is unreal. His first ever touch in college football was a 35-yard like run touchdown. Like, it was unreal. And then we have Elijah Holyfield, who's our 4, who's Evander Holyfield's son, who is like also unreal. And then we are picking up another guy, DeAndre Swift. I think he's a 4 or 5 star recruit coming in, who's just like also ridiculous. You know how Bleacher Report makes those like commitment videos, like they made one for him.
I saw that video.
Yeah, it was like a Rocky spoof, but like,
yeah, that's right. That's
you know what I mean? So like, we're like, they call us like running back university. Like, we are like loaded in running backs, but it's just funny, kind of the waves that it has, like all the way into high school,
right?
Like, where are people gonna go? So yeah, it's just kind of like really interesting to like at this time, as like bowl games are wrapping up and like people start looking to the draft and like recruits are making their decisions, it's like all happens at the same time, and I think that's like a really cool.
I also think it's crazy that McCaffrey is like so good, and we like talk about how good he is, but he's supposed to go like to the Patriots at like number 32 in the draft, which is crazy.
I think, well, the thing is, like, I think the running backs are, I mean, the NFL is great running backs, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like, the people looking, you know, in the first, you know, the Browns need a quarterback, you know what I mean? Like, Jonathan Allen,
need a quarterback, Vikings need a quarterback.
Yeah, the Vikings especially need a quarterback. You know, people are like scrambling. Like, so Mitch Trubisky for
UNC.
He's projected to go like 7th, I saw.
Is he?
Yeah, like Jonathan Allen, who's a defensive end. I think pound for pound is the best defensive player in the country.
He's the Alabama defensive.
He's Alabama
defensive.
So he's unreal. And I think he's going to go high too. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I think people are focusing more now on building like offensive line, defensive line, stuff like that, than looking for running backs now.
Is there a quarterback that's coming out of college this year that's supposed to be like the next amazing great thing? Like, I don't think there's a quarterback that's supposed to come
out of college.
Yeah.
So you've got Wyoming's quarterback that is kind of like laid low because he's Wyoming's quarterback, but apparently his draft stock is super high. He's supposed to go like top 15.
Browning from Washington? Yeah. Is he supposed
No. Oh, Browning. I don't know where Browning's going.
He's not. I don't know if he's going. I was just naming quarterbacks and I knew that.
Trubisky's going. Jalen Hurts is a freshman. Yeah. Jacob Eason is a freshman.
Deshaun Watson, actually.
Deshaun is supposed to go pretty high.
He'll go pretty high. He's good.
So yeah, it's pretty cool.
Ohio State. Who's Ohio State's quarterback?
JT Barrett.
Is he
I think he's a junior. I think he's going to stay. I haven't heard. I feel like they'd make a big deal if he were declaring, and I haven't really seen anything about him declaring. So Malik Hooker is a cornerback. He's a defensive back for Ohio State. I think he's the best, one of the best defensive backs in the country. I think Maurice Smith is also. I mean, no bias. I think he is also one of the best. The dude is unreal. Like he had the game-winning touchdown against Auburn, which was a pick six, and we won 13-7.
Yeah, I saw that.
Which is just like, I don't know. He's on another level. But yeah, so it's just really interesting to kind of see where it all.
I wanted to bring you back to just your whole bowl game experience.
Right. So we kind of got.
So you got to this hotel where they trained ducks and. After this duck ceremony,
you guys were in Memphis for a little bit before the game. Like, when did you fly in, and when was the game, or driving, whatever?
So what happened was, like, I got off from break. I got like 3 days at home. I don't know when I got. It was like the 9th of December or something like that. And then I was in Athens for 7 days or 8 days, just straight practice. And then I got 3 days off, and on Christmas Day, we had to report to Memphis.
Jeez.
So I flew out at like 2 p.m. on Christmas Day and got to Memphis at like 6 or 7. And then we practiced all week. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Bowl game was Friday. So we practiced at a Rhodes College.
Small school?
Yeah, small school. Really small school. Gorgeous school. But they had like a nice turf field and everything like that. So it was cool to go kind of set up. And we're not really doing as many videos because we're doing like practice videos for social media and everything like that.
Right.
So I got to kind of focus on taking pictures, which was fun.
And your photos were looking good. You were posting them on the gram.
Yeah.
And on Twitter, actually. I think I saw them on both.
This is kind of selfish of me. Every time we post one from the Georgia football, I'll just like share the photos that Georgia football posts on Facebook on my Facebook, or like retweet the photos that we tweeted out on, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I don't know. Like, they got good reactions. I was happy about that. But we got to go to a Bass Pro Shop, which is like the largest Bass Pro Shop they have.
Yeah, I've seen it on your Snapchat.
It's the old I think it's the old Grizzlies Coliseum, and it's a massive pyramid.
What?
Yeah, it's a massive pyramid, and like, it's like not hollowed out. I mean, of course it's hollowed out, but like,
right.
It's just this massive Bass Pro Shop, and they've got like alligators in there. It's like a zoo almost. Like, they have like alligators in there and like all these fish swimming around, and like you can buy like boats, and like they gave us a $50 gift card, and they were like, you know, go, you can buy whatever you want.
So what did you get?
So, you know, a lot of it was like camo and like,
right. Yeah. You know,
a lot of people bought
your
like
style,
bullets, and I was like, you know, like one guy bought a shotgun, which is weird because it was like a $1,600 shotgun.
That gift card, though.
I was like, why did you choose to buy it now? It's like a $50 gift. Just buy it at home. Like,
I've just been waiting for that opportunity to get a shotgun.
It's kind of weird, but like, I mean,
that's where college players get in trouble.
Yeah, well, he was a video guy.
Okay,
he was coaches video, but so I bought like a North Face like running jacket in the hopes that I will start running, which is
2017.
Know, yeah,
resolution.
New me. It's like completely unrealistic, but it looks cool. So, but it was weird. They had like a bowling alley and like, what? Yeah, man.
In the
they had like a restaurant. Like, it was like a resort. Like, you know how resorts, how they have those like, I don't know, those gates that you push through that are like the prongs. You know what I'm talking about?
The turn.
Yeah, it turns out they had those at like the Bass Pro Shop. Like, what is going on here? Like,
it's like a roller coaster. They give you like tickets.
Yeah. Stuff like so that was part of the bowl gift, which is pretty cool.
And wow.
We got these backpacks. So.
What?
Yeah. So, which was also great because my backpack broke.
Oh.
In the airport. Okay. So I was like, I need a new backpack.
And they're like, well, here you
and
go.
Like, here you go. And I was like, yes. but I got a new pair of shoes, which is pretty funny. There's a really big Nike distribution center in Memphis. So they gave us, apparently they gave us all the reject shoes. So there were like all these different kinds of shoes. So some people got like highlighter yellow and pink, like Nikes. And like some people got like LeBrons, but like you had no idea like what you were going to get. So like I got some really nice like black Flyknit free runs.
Nice.
Which were just like black with a white swoosh and a white bottom. So like really simple.
Super
like,
clean. Workout.
And yeah. I'm just glad I didn't get the highlighter yellow. And then, I got a pair of slides and a bull watch, which was just like a Bulova. I'd never really heard of that. It's just like a kind of a link watch or whatever. And it on the face, it just says like
Liberty Bowl.
Yeah, Liberty Bowl, TCU versus Georgia.
Nice.
They hooked you guys up with
slides. Yeah, they hooked
us up. I didn't realize all this happened for bowl games.
It was really nice. Yeah, the bowl gifts are awesome.
And this was just... This was for players? Like, do players also players get this support stuff?
Yeah. So okay. Players got it originally, and then we got it. Because I think they messed up the order or something like that, and we right. might not have gotten it, which I was like, that's yeah. okay. But it was kind of like a nice surprise. Like, 3 days into it, they're like, come get your bowl gifts. And I was like, don't mind if I do. but, yeah, no. So it was cool, and we practiced at Rhodes College, and we ate really good barbecue and ribs. And then I was up at 6:30 on game day, cause the game started at 11 cause we're central time.
Right.
So, yeah, it was like 30 degrees outside and I had all this like thermal gear on and then it heated up to like 60 degrees by the time like the game started. So then I was like shedding layers on the side. but it was cool. TCU is like a weird team to play because they run the hurry up and they run like a lot of different, you know, like, you don't know if they're going to run the option, you know, if they're going to run like a screen pass or a flea flicker, you know? So, like, I'd, like, take a video and I'd be, like, you know, adjusting my settings and they would have already run a play. And I was like, oh, come on. Like, it'd be, like, a great tackle by one of the linebackers. And I'd be like, oh, I missed it. But I just thought they weren't, like, ready. We run a very traditional pro-style offense and where it's just, like, we just run through them. And that worked very well for us because Nick Chubb and Sonny Michelle are very good at just, like, running over people. So I don't think they were quite ready for our size.
You guys won by like what? Eight points?
Yeah, we won 31?
21-13. Or no.
23.
Oh gosh, I should know this, man. Let me look it up. It was like 31-23. Okay. Yeah. So yeah, it was a good game. We scored 10 points in the final quarter. But yeah, it was a good game and then I got on a flight. I woke up at 3:45 the next morning, got on a flight and flew to Charlotte and then flew here. I was back in Raleigh around 11. And that's when you texted me.
Yeah.
I was like falling asleep in the car. but then I got this weird like spurt of energy.
Because kind of about regretted. Our podcast, right?
Yeah. but yeah, no, it's a fun trip. It hasn't really felt like I've had much of a winter break.
Right.
Because
well, you haven't had a lot of a winter break.
It's been like 3 days work, 3 days work, and now I've had 3 days, and then semester starts.
How do you feel about that? I kind of like being busy with things.
I like being busy, but like there are just some times where I'm just like, I don't want to do anything. So like, I really liked being busy with bowl trip, but I would have liked if I had like, you know, 5-6 days to like here, just kind of like
enjoy the holiday,
you know,
I guess.
Like, it didn't really feel like Christmas and New Year's didn't really feel like, I don't really feel like I had any sort of holiday.
Did you end up doing Christmas? Like, did you
enjoy Christmas at home?
Okay.
But then I like immediately flew out to
like, you like grabbed the presents and unwrapped them in
the
car
like,
on the way
we
to
like
the
went to church and then like unwrapped presents, like ate brunch and then like I grabbed whatever presents I got and I wanted to take, like this jacket and like a couple books and like threw it in a bag and we got in the car and left.
Jeez.
So yeah, it was fun though. I really, it was my first bowl trip.
And so hopefully you'll have at least two more of those.
Yeah.
Right.
If I don't declare early for the draft.
So. Right. Right.
but yeah, so I'll have hopefully two more of those.
So anyone can declare for the draft, right? I heard that for basketball. So I was going to probably declare sometime.
Yeah, no, I was hoping you would. I've got a lot of money on you going.
Right.
So
I was going to just declare. And if the team calls me in, I guess I'll work out for them.
You
only
have to fill
the
like a form, apparently.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just like, it's this like, a couple pages. It's like I'll have to read into it if I actually have to play college basketball.
No, I don't think you do. I really
do. I have to play any level of basketball? I
you
played
have to be
no
like
levels
a certain age
basketball.
Though, because they have, that's why the whole one and done rule.
Right.
So but you don't have to go to college. I think you can like, I don't know.
Wait, you can only declare once. Wait, what did you say? One and done?
Well,
no,
it's
like
you have to go to 1 year of college.
Okay.
Because
okay.
Then you
yeah.
High schoolers.
Sorry.
But like, I remember Marcus Page in his draft application or whatever, like they said, like, what's your best shot? And he wrote like the double clutch three pointer or like the double pump three pointer. So it's just like, I don't know. I thought that was cool, but okay. Apparently it's not cool, guys. But yeah. How's basketball been going for
Basketball has been going good. I started doing video for them. This is a little bit back. And so I've switched over from football now to basketball, so pretty much I'm just more important than Neil. No, just kidding. I didn't get invited to the bowl game. That's okay. I wish I got a swag bag. I wonder if I'm sure our team did. I'm curious what was in ours, because
you can look them up. What bowl were you in?
The toilet bowl.
I got it.
Independence Bowl is my guess.
Independence.
Yeah, that's right.
Independence Bowl.
But anyway, so I was, I filmed the basketball games, and I'm starting to get to know the basketball players, which is cool. That's why awesome. We could get Malik on the last podcast. Shout out to Malik /WaveboyColor/ we're working on your logo. Please don't hate us. So it's interesting getting to know them a little bit more. They're very cool people. And I think for me, it's easier to get to know them more than football, because there's less of them. There's only like 13 versus 50, 60 players on the sideline, all screaming profanity at each other. While the basketball team, the basketball team, like before the game, they don't really get super hyped. They listen to loud music and they just kind of like chill. And then they come out on the court, take some shots, and then they play the game.
That must be really cool to kind of see what they're doing like behind the scenes. Right. I always think that's like the coolest part.
Right. Even with football, it was really
cool. What everybody doesn't see. You know what I mean?
Right. Like, I didn't realize, I mean, and I was talking to our guest on the last podcast, Alex Mentzer, shout out, about how like in warmups, I'll just watch, like before anyone's even in the stadium or the arena, and they just like don't miss. And I just find that super impressive, because I go out there, like I also get to go out there and shoot around.
Right.
Because
there's no way.
So, and I miss every shot. So it's just like,
that's so cool though.
The two of us, I'm taking jump shots with like Maverick Rowan or, Yosmer. What's his
name?
Stephen Omer or something like that. Whatever
Dennis
his name
Jr.?
Is. No, he doesn't come out early. He comes out, dunks the ball once, and walks back in. Everyone's like, yeah.
Is he a freshman?
Yeah, he's a freshman.
He's unreal.
Yeah, he's supposed to go forward to the Miami Heat.
He's a one and done?
I think so.
No way.
Oh, yeah, man.
Projected to. Him and...
I mean, it makes sense. He's just dirty.
I hope he stays.
He was on top 10 for that dunk.
No, that was pretty
The windmill?
Dirty. Yeah.
I didn't
film.
It was Austin.
That was Austin.
I want to meet Austin. I've like messaged Austin on Instagram a couple times, but I've never actually like met him.
He needs to come on the podcast.
Yeah, you should have him on the podcast.
You should come on the podcast. You can come talk about graphic design, and hopefully you can hook me up with Bradley Chubb so he can come on the podcast.
Austin, I want to meet you, by the way.
I don't think he listens to these things, but he could. I don't know. Anyway, so he helps me, or he does all the video, and then so ACC play starts for us. The second game of ACC play, because we just got crushed by Miami. I'm sorry about that, basketball team. But we're playing on Thursday, and that's our first home ACC game. So I'm going to film that, and that should be exciting. It's at like 9 o'clock, 8 or 9. So it should be a good time.
So you get like all access pass, basically.
Yeah, I mean, I just walk around. I mean, I like same thing with football. Like they always said we needed these passes, and I have all these passes. Like if NC State's listening,
walk around with confidence.
Yeah, I have all the credentials. Yeah. If you need to see them, but like. Honestly, like for the football games, I would just walk around the empty stadium, and like no one does anything. Yeah, same thing with basketball. Like I just walk onto the floor.
That's what football is like.
Yeah, but apparently the refs in basketball, Austin was telling me that they're like super, they're like really into it. And he's been like yanked off the court. He's not supposed to be on the court. So I'm trying not to get in the ref's way, because I don't want to have to beat up a ref. I'm kidding. please don't take away my passes. It's so much fun to be on the court. But yeah, so I'll just like sit on the court. I like sit under the table because it's,
wait, really?
Yeah, like I'm on the baseline. On one of the sides. Under, because usually we have two. I shoot with the FS700.
Yeah, so what's your setup like?
So I shoot in super slow-mo, at least thus far.
Was it 240?
Yeah, 240 or 120, depending on what. I mean, at that point, I don't think people can tell.
Yeah.
Well, 240, the lights flicker. 140, the lights don't flicker.
It's because it's faster. Each frame is faster than like the frequency of
light.
That's I think that's really cool.
Yeah, I mean, I like the lights flickering, but there's other people
who don't like
higher up than me. Yeah. And by higher up, I mean literally anyone else besides me. And so we shoot at 240, then we work it down to 30 frames. I don't know what the word is for that. We
interpret the footage.
Interpret. There you go. Yeah. Thank you. We interpret it down to 30.
30? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And so it's just all handheld stuff, and I just shoot whatever. But we're getting a A7S2.
No way.
At some point, I think Austin has put in there. It's gotten confirmed, but now just has to go through budget stuff.
So you have Adobe Creative Cloud?
Yeah.
So like, where do you like edit? Do you guys have like an office or like?
No. Well, Austin has an office, but usually we just like he does the editing for some of the stuff, or if he has to shoot, then I'll edit.
Right.
So we kind of just take turns on it. So like, why it's such a pain is because he has to like label all the clips. So while I'm shooting, I'll just reach up, hand him my memory card. He'll hand me another one. I'll just keep
shooting. Oh, you guys have a table.
Yeah. He sits at the table. I sit on the ground.
That's awesome. Because I get to shoot. That's a really good setup.
Yeah. So that's why there's two of us.
That's a really good setup.
And then we have a third guy, Kai, who does photography for us. And so for Austin, it's not like I'm a part of the head honchos that make these decisions. But so he goes around and he shoots photos. And he's a really good photographer.
That's sweet.
So that's
cool. Like you just hate him. Yeah. So like so in the zone. Yeah, like card.
Yeah, he's like, Ben, I need the card. And I'm like, just reach out. So sometimes it's because we're like, because rendering the footage on the camera takes a little bit.
Yeah.
And basketball happens so fast. So I can really get one play at a time.
Right.
So sometimes while I'm rendering it, I'll miss like a really cool play. And then I get sad, and then I don't record for a couple minutes, and then
I cry a little bit, and then to wipe the floor up.
Right. This is a pain. But yeah, it's cool. It's interesting to be on the floor. The basketball players are just so tall.
Yeah.
I feel like both with football and basketball, you just get a different perspective when you get to sit so close to these people and like
they're
you
so
get to
big. Interact. Football players are massive.
I was standing on the sideline of the football, like while I was standing, and like I was just looking at some of the offensive linemen. I'm like, man, their thighs are just so gigantic.
Like, yeah,
they're like, just tree trunks.
There are some guys on the offensive lineman on Georgia who are, you know, we're all like, I say we. all the like offensive linemen on Georgia's team, I think, are around 300, if not over 300. And like,
I mean, that's just the standard nowadays, which is insane. Crazy.
But like, you know, they put on cleats, which add like a couple inches, and then they put on pads, and then you're just like, oh my gosh, like this is not a human being. This man is huge. But yeah, so I know exactly what you mean. And then you're like trying to like, you know, push them apart so you can get like a view of the game.
And like, super nice. Like the offensive and defensive lines are like while I was recording football, those are like my favorite people to hang around. Like and like record, because they're always doing cool stuff. I enjoy the intricacy of like what they do, and like when they're talking on the sideline, they're talking all this jargon that I don't understand, but like it's very cool. They're talking about like they like rewind the play, and they seem pretty smart at football.
Right.
They're like, hey, we need to. I overextended on this guy. He did this type of block while we ran this scheme.
Right.
And the coach is like yelling at them the whole time. And,
it's people are like, oh yeah, football. You just hit each other. Like, it is so difficult. Like, I bet if they taught like a film theory class in college, like the majority of people would fail it. Like, it is like learning coverages and like play call and everything like that is like, I don't know, blows my mind how these guys know. And like, probably, you know, this is like a lot of the play call in college is like 7-8 words long,
right?
You know,
right,
so they
right.
like all they want to run is like a halfback dive, you know what I mean? Like Z right, like razor wide, like double screen, X cross.
Yeah,
and you're like, what is that? Like, you know, they say one different word, it's a completely different, you know what I mean?
Right. But, so it's crazy how like the quarterback has to he has to know what the coach wants him to run, and then has to be able to communicate that with his wide receivers.
Yeah,
and I still swear sometimes wide receivers just do whatever they want. Yeah. I swear that's a play. Like, hey, just go out, like, just get open.
Was that the water fountain? But no, yeah, I have like so much respect for those guys who are just like no, and then you get in the NFL and it's like 18 words. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
I know those playbooks are like, you know, binders are massive.
Yeah, and that's why you have to memorize the playbook, and that's why it takes a couple days to get acclimated to the different teams.
Do you know Dylan Parham? He's a redshirt freshman quarterback.
Here?
Okay. Yeah.
Dylan Parham.
His mom taught me English.
Oh, cool.
I knew him in, like, elementary middle school.
Wow.
But he's a redshirt freshman quarterback, yeah. Cool. He went to Southeast.
Wow.
So, I don't know. I was just wondering.
So you said you had a phone call yesterday?
Oh, yes, that's right.
Yes. Okay. I might have to hide this from my Twitter account so that if he's creeping on my Twitter account, he doesn't see this. But so my cousin knows this guy, and he works for Discovery Channel, and he's 23 years old. And
what does he do for Discovery?
Yeah,
wow.
This is crazy. Virtual reality. He, listen to this. No. This is crazy. I can't believe I had this call with him. He is created the first 360 GoPro rig ever. So do you guys remember when Casey Neistat had that guy on to make that 360 video where they blew everything up in his office? Right. That was him.
Really?
Yeah. That was him.
He's like buddies with Casey Neistat. Like, he's like, what? And Casey Neistat, he's like the like leading expert in VR. And he's like, that's not true. Like, he legitimately is. Like, it's unreal.
I mean, Casey just has that Samsung camera
now. Yeah, now he just has that one camera. Like, he designed this and like went to a 3D printer and was like, can you print this? And like, will it work? And they were like, yeah, let's try it. And it turned into like 40 guys on a Facebook forum like trying to figure out how to make it work. And then he said like it worked. And they paired up with Facebook and then they like turned into this really big thing. And like it really took off. And so he got to hire a team of his buddies and like, you know, they're like traveling around the world making 360 videos. And
that's awesome.
Yeah, it was really cool. But I was just like, oh my gosh, this dude is like he honestly pioneered like 360 videos.
So would you say you're friends with this person?
You know,
next question that's going to happen after I ask
that
question.
Acquainted. So okay. My cousin is friends with him. And okay. So I emailed him and was like, hey, like, you got any like internships or like you think I could call you and talk to you about like, you know, how to make myself more marketable or like, you know, any places I should look for internships. So
right.
He was like, yeah, I could, you know, love to talk to
this
you.
This is the friend of the cousin?
Yeah. Okay. And so we talked for like 45 minutes. He's like the coolest dude ever. But we were just like talking and and he was like, yeah, if you ever want to come to DC and like, yeah, I'll show you around. And I was like, yes.
what?
So yeah, it was just a really cool phone call. I had no idea what to expect, but it was just like, you know, like he's, you know, I don't know.
So he seems like a person that we should get on the pod.
He's super chill.
So what do you mean when you said 3D printing?
He 3D printed the prototype?
So the first like...
Oh, he 3D printed the prototype.
Yeah, so like the first like true like 360 rig was like four or five GoPros like on rig.
And then, combine all the footage.
And then you stitch it. So that rig was what he built. So it's like the first true like 360 rig with GoPros and everything.
See, that's what I've been getting into kind of recently is 3D printing.
Okay.
And it's like it takes so much time to do.
Really?
And like the way you design things is kind of weird because if you have like empty spaces in the 3D printer, you got to orientate it correctly. Otherwise, the 3D printer is going to build like a scaffold inside. Whoa. so it can't print on air, right? So it has to build this weird scaffold thing, and that can affect your print when you're like chipping it out and stuff like that.
Wild.
Anyway, there's a lot of intricate details that go into 3D printing.
I know nothing about
that. That's really cool.
There's a lot that goes into 3D printing that is just like, holy cow. There's
like, you know, it started out with like him and a couple guys, and then like they have like 5,000 people on the VR staff.
That's crazy.
Like, I know. Or actually, jeez. I don't know if that's true.
The question is, does he work with Planet Earth? Because those are the people. Are the people I'm trying to find, and I cannot find them anywhere. Like I've looked so hard for these people.
They're not on Planet Earth. But
I met these guys who were filming something for like this service award that a guy on our team won.
Okay.
And they were a full staff production crew, 11 of them.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was like the smallest production crew they had. They had a U-Haul of all this stuff. They had like, you guys know what like Arri Alexas are? They're like some of the nicest cameras you could buy. They're like Reds, but like more expensive.
More expensive, right?
Yeah, like I think like a Red was like their B camera.
Okay.
What? So we're like, yeah, okay, cool, man. want to give us one? But they were like shooting this thing in Athens and then like packing it all the next day and flying to Africa to shoot a documentary like Planet Earth. That's how they described it to us.
Wow.
Like, hey, give me a job. but no, yeah, I was just like, that's the closest I've ever come to seeing anybody shoot anything like that. But,
do you know anything about Leica cameras?
They're insanely nice film cameras.
Okay, yeah.
Like, super high quality film cameras. And I know that a lot of their medium format cameras are also really good. I don't know much about their digital line.
I don't know. I don't know if you know who John Olsen is. He's a snowboarder slash skier for Red Bull.
Yeah.
Oh. And yes. Anyway, so he started a daily vlog. I guess this year in 2016.
Is
and
on YouTube?
Yeah, let's I mean, go. I say started, but he's like 200 episodes in now.
I'm gonna watch all of them.
And so, but his vlogs are just insane because he shoots them in 4K every single day, and like he started off, he just had this man who just followed him everywhere. And so then he made the daily vlog, and now he's like making his own. And he's so rich, he has access to all this equipment, and I don't know, his vlogs are just he uses Leica, and I didn't know if it was just a European company
I just know that they produce like really high quality
footage
or film cameras.
Okay
I know that I think their lenses were really nice too. I haven't heard.
They're quite expensive.
Yeah, I haven't heard much about
how expensive
them
are they
since.
I thought they're like 2 to 3.
I saw one of their medium formats and it was like 40. That might have been a House of Blood though.
Okay, I'm just lying to you guys. So the camera that he uses is $7,000. Yeah. Which is just crazy to record a daily vlog on a $7,000 camera. But, I think they just have like regular consumer cameras that are like
$1,200. You can get like Sony.
I mean,
it's like when these guys like Ben Brown or like, all of them. Ben Brown is really one of the only vloggers he's the only vlogger I watch.
Well, really?
Casey canceled the vlog.
Yeah. So Casey canceled the vlog. But I feel like I just like,
I dropped off from him a little bit.
I relate
towards
to him
the end
more in terms of like, I don't know, photography and like coffee and stuff. Like, I don't know. I feel like I would be better friends with him than like anybody else.
Ben
like,
Brown.
I relate to him.
Fun
more.
For Louis.
Yeah, I like Fun for Louis, but like Ben Brown is more of like a gearhead. You know what I mean? Like he loves all the gear and he loves like the photography aspect. And I think Fun for Louis is more like, I like the adventure.
Yeah.
And like Ben Brown
live
is,
the adventure.
Is
I mean
like
that's
that
his
too,
thing.
But. I think Ben Brown. I think
Ben Brown seems like a cool guy. I'd like to talk to him.
I like his visual vibes a lot, which are his last one was really cool.
The Arctic visual vibes was really good.
But like he was vlogging on like a 1DX Mark II at one point. Like I mean that's because he vlogs on a 5D Mark IV now, and like he vlogged on an A7S Mark II. Like you know what I mean? Like it's just like unreal. Like the equipment.
Yeah, I mean he gets sponsored. Like he and his wife.
Girlfriend.
That's crazy. They've been dating
a while.
Yeah,
dating a long time. But they're like planning this huge trip throughout Africa next year.
Yeah. Well, Land Rover, I think, sponsors that.
Well, because they have
BMW thing too.
Their truck or their thing. Pumba. I can't remember the name. It's
Pumba. Pumba. Yeah.
They're trying to get it refurbished.
Yeah, got like beat up. But I bet the thing is, they have such a good relationship with Land Rover. I have no doubt that Land Rover is going to come through for them. You
but
know what I mean?
They,
like,
they don't even want. They don't want a new one though.
They just
want new parts.
I think they just want the engine replaced.
Yeah. I mean, the body to that car is
unreal.
Sick. Yeah. So, and they have a 10 on top of it and everything.
Like,
it's like wow.
That's like my dream car. I'm trying to do a trip to Iceland my spring break, and I'm looking to try to rent one of those cars.
Really?
Just by yourself? Or
I'm trying to go with one of my friends. But like
Iceland is
super expensive to go.
Iceland's incredible. The landscapes there are just insane.
To rent a Land Rover for a week. And I was like, but at the same time, I'm like, it's Iceland, so I feel like anything less, I'd get stuck. But yeah, no, my spring break is March 4th to the 11th.
Is that our spring break?
I think that's your spring break.
Is that my spring break? I don't know. I'll have to look it up.
Hey, if you want to go to Iceland,
hey,
let me know.
Look, I'm like not even that opposed to it.
Let's do it. Plane tickets are pretty cheap.
I mean, that's
it's like, I think it's like $600 round trip.
That's not even bad.
Not even bad.
Yeah.
So, are you guys camping it or like
so
how,
what
you,
I was
how,
thinking,
how you doing?
Literally just sleep in the back of the Land Rover. Or like, and then when we're in like town, sleep in like an Airbnb.
Yeah.
But like, I was just trying to want to drive around the island. My friend, do you guys know who Benjamin Hartman is? The Instagram, he's like an Instagram photographer. When Ben Brown went to Iceland, he met up with Benjamin Hardman. Benjamin Hardman is like one of my favorite photographers. He's killing it on Instagram. He's got like 600,000 followers.
This is your friend?
No. Oh. My friend went to Iceland and on a trip with him, with Benjamin. And he's like good friends with Benjamin now.
Okay.
And like through that, he went like this guy's name is Colin Rex. You should follow him on Instagram. He's in Raleigh. You guys should have him on the podcast.
We'll have anyone on the podcast.
He's got awesome stories. He graduated from USC in May and then just like rented a Land Rover with his buddies.
South Carolina or Southern California?
South Carolina.
Okay.
He like rented a Land Rover with his buddies after he graduated and like drove around Patagonia for like a month or something like that. And then like he went to Iceland with Benjamin Hartman for like 2 weeks.
Can you spell the name?
Colin Rex?
Yeah.
Colin Rex.
Okay, cool.
Colin Rex.
Okay. Look him up on Instagram and look up Benjamin Hartman on Instagram. But like his photos are unreal. But I think he got a job with Arc'teryx because of that.
Really?
Like the outdoors company. Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Which I was like,
all right, so we have to know that Neil has the hookup for every guest of the podcast we could ever want. Neil's like, oh, yeah, I know the founder of Discovery.
He's actually our scheduler. He works behind the scenes, but sometimes we allow him to hop on the microphone. Yeah.
But, I mean, like, should we actually, like, look into, like, actually hiring Neil full-time to just schedule as guests? Yeah. Absolutely.
I mean, we can pay you nothing. We'll buy you a coffee every now and then.
No, I was talking to that guy. He was like, yeah, if Casey has any jobs hiring at CNN, I'll let you know. And I was like, yes. And he goes, yeah, I'll take the job first. I was like, I'll get you coffee. And he's like, deal. But
I'd like to talk to Casey. Casey's just a crazy man. He's just so he's wild.
I think he's in South Africa right now.
He's in South Africa, I believe.
South Africa is such a cool place, man.
Yeah, that's why I want to study abroad there at some point. You should. Or just at least go there once.
It's super cool.
I know, I
forget that you've been there.
You've been there twice, right?
I went there senior year, spring break. And my parents went, it was me and my parents, and my brother didn't have spring break. So my parents went back because they liked it so much with my brother. That's the great thing. Whenever I get a credit card, I'm going to hook it up to airline miles. So my dad was, whenever they use their credit card, they get frequent flyer miles.
Right.
So it just like makes traveling so much cheaper. Because like we just use up frequent flyer miles and it's like super discounted prices.
Right.
So I don't know. And then like we always stay at Hilton. So he's a bunch of like rewards points at Hilton too. I don't know. It's just like my dad has figured out how to travel.
Travel cheaply. That's
travel cheaply. Yeah. I think everybody knows how to travel. It's just
he's the only one to figure it out.
But yeah, so he's just got to figure it out. So yeah, we went. I was there for like, I think it was like 2 weeks or like 10 days or something like that. And literally it was the most gorgeous place I've ever been.
I mean, it has everything. It has mountains. It has the beaches. I don't know if it has snow.
I sat on a beach and looked up at a mountain. Like, I mean, it's unreal. That's and like cool.
It has penguins too, doesn't it? Like,
we saw penguins. They came from South Pole. They swim up every...
that's so awesome.
Yeah, I mean, it was wild. And it was like their fall because it's Southern Hemisphere. But just like, it's gorgeous, man. Like, I don't know. The culture is crazy too because it's close to the Indian Ocean. So you're getting like, you know, like Indian, Southeast Asian culture. You're also getting some African culture, but you got a lot of Dutch, you know, because the Dutch came and ruined everything with colonizing. you know what I mean? Like, it's just super, super cool. We went to like the southernmost point of Africa and like that was wild. I don't know. I really wish I was a better photographer when I went because like it's just like a really picturesque city.
Yeah, I mean, Ben Brown does that. He lives there, and he lives in Surrey, England, which are the two places I'm looking at studying abroad. Ironically.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Funnily enough, so I was going to actually talk to him.
But no, yeah, I really, really, I would highly recommend it. Would you be at the University
of Cape Town?
It's like, have you seen the campus?
Yeah,
it's
looks
gorgeous.
Crazy.
It is beautiful. So yeah, I mean, I would just. 10 out of 10 would recommend.
Yeah. Neil just hates traveling. He just likes staying home.
But my brother and I are going to try to do a trip because my brother is graduating. So his graduation trip is we're going to like Prague, Vienna, and Budapest or whatever.
Ooh.
And then my brother and I are staying an extra week.
Just you two?
We're going to stay.
That'd be cool.
It's the
family. My whole family is doing those three cities. And then the extra week is just my brother and I.
Oh, okay. That's still
we're
cool.
We're going to do... a lot of small towns in the Italian Alps. We're going to do like hikes and then take a train to another small town and stay there and do day hikes and Alps and back. So I'm really excited for the photos and stuff like that too.
That's cool.
So Frequent flyer miles, man. Shout out.
I think I'm going to Bojangles sometime over the next week.
I like really want to take out a credit card so I can do that, but then I realized like that's probably the dumbest thing I could do right now.
Yeah. I think, yeah.
I mean, you can use a credit card like a debit card. You just got to be like diligent. Be
super diligent.
Yeah.
You can't just forget. And then like the next month, you're like, oh, yeah, I just owe my entire life to exactly. this credit card
company. Yeah.
I'm gonna wait until I graduate.
Or I heard that you can just like get credit cards and then like put them somewhere, so then you just have good credit indefinitely, because once you have credit cards,
I think you have to use
it. Do you have to use it? Because the thing is, like, you have to pay, like, some credit cards, you pay, like, $200 a year to have that credit card.
Right.
So, like, if you're not using the credit card, I feel like it's not worth it.
You're throwing away $200.
Yeah, throwing away $200 a year.
It's not even that bad.
I imagine there's, like, probably some way to do it, though.
I think I'm sure there's some way, because
like, if you're paying off your bill, like, every month on time, and like you're using your credit card like a debit card, but you just have good sense to not overspend. Like
right.
You're getting like
if you just
really
know how
good,
much money you have.
Like the thing is like, because
that's what
is,
I've been doing
lately.
If you
pay for everything
with
a credit card, then your credit score goes way up because you're paying it off on time.
It's consistent use
then
and then you're paying. Yeah.
You're also getting all the rewards because every time you spend money,
right,
you're using your credit card.
Right.
So like every dollar you spend, you're getting 2 freaking 5 miles. Sweet.
It's just like buying stuff and immediately paying it off, just like right there.
I wonder if you can buy a
plane
ticket.
Can you link any credit card to a frequent? Is it like an airline credit card?
Okay. I'd want to do like Delta or something like
right,
that.
Right, right. One that gets everywhere for sure.
Yeah. And
I like
especially
JetBlue. JetBlue has TVs JetBlue is cool. on their planes. Yeah. I don't know if it's all planes, but like we flew from like Florida to North Carolina like last week.
Really?
They had TVs. I was watching the UNC basketball game.
No way.
Yeah. And it was just like
I thought it was cool. Just like you're just sending TVs. I didn't know you could do live television.
No, it was like live television.
Wait, that's awesome.
Yeah, wow.
I know. And I don't think Delta has that.
No.
But I don't know. Not to like crap on Delta. I know Delta got in like huge trouble. Do you see the Delta, the boycott Delta hashtag?
Oh, that because that guy got kicked off the plane.
Nah.
But did you hear what like happened? The prank they were doing.
Well, I don't know if it was ever confirmed that it was like a prank, but I know
I heard it was like a pretending to be ISIS prank.
Is that what it was?
That's what I like. Definitely heard they were like.
I know that they were
trying to sketch people out, and then as soon as they were like got in trouble for it, they hit record.
I mean, I don't know. It was crazy. Like that whole day was wild. His tweet blew up, and then people were like, "Well, you're a prankster, so should we believe you?" And he's like, "No, seriously, this happened."
But then the whole prank was because he's had making people on planes uncomfortable, like making people uncomfortable on planes prank before.
Delta's
had a history of being like when that Trump guy was younger, they like banned him from all flights.
Did they?
You know what I mean? So I feel like Delta, and then Delta like stood by their by kicking them off the plane. Like,
right.
And I feel like if any company, like for a guy that kicks someone off who's being offensive to Trump people, they wouldn't just kick or stand by kicking off the guy for speaking Arabic. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Then again, like if they did, like that's.
I know, yeah.
Terrible.
So, yeah, like, so, like, I would hope, like, for him, I would hope that, like, as terrible as it is, I would hope that they actually did what he said they did.
I think I secretly, like, am just wanting Delta to be right about this guy doing the prank so that I don't have to, like, face the fact that that was, like, something terrible that Delta
right,
did. You know
right.
what I mean?
Yeah, like, I hope Delta didn't do something terrible.
Yeah,
but at the same time, I hope this guy's not just lying for attention because he's done it before. Yeah. And this one he seems more serious about, but it's kind of blown over. Like, I've not heard anything about it.
I mean, it seems that, like, on all these news sources, he's definitely a hoaxer. And, I mean, it kind of gets what he gets. I'm going to be on Delta's side, too.
I just think, I don't know. They were saying, like, they were, you know, I don't know. That was like one of the pranks. It was like making people uncomfortable on a plane, and like, I feel like now is not the greatest time to be doing pranks like that. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like,
I don't know. There's just kind of a line when it's a prank, and that's not
a
prank.
I feel like planes just are,
I feel like
are not a good place
off
to
limits
do.
For
like yeah,
most
like,
of everything.
Airports
like, put
too.
On your headphones and like read a book.
Yeah, just don't bother anybody.
Don't
like,
do anything. Like, I just, you know, I don't know.
Like, I barely have conversations with anyone who sits next to me on a plane. By barely, I mean I don't talk to
them. I don't
want
to talk
if it's
to
my
flight
family.
Attendant. Like, you know. Like,
yeah.
Like, yeah.
Like, I'm just like, yes, ma'am. Like, oh, thank you so much. Like, I'm just like, I don't know. I usually just sleep through it.
I agree. That's exactly what I do.
I just
every
feel
single
like
time.
There should be like no, like even if he did was playing a prank and had nothing to do with him speaking Arabic and he got kicked off. Like, yeah, that's terrible. They get kicked off, but just like in general, like just don't do pranks on planes.
I mean, I don't know why I'd want to mess with people.
People don't mess around.
I feel like there's a good reason why they shouldn't mess around.
Absolutely not, yeah. But
if he was just like, hi, mom, yeah, whatever he was saying, and then some passengers were like, hey, that's making me uncomfortable, you need to leave. Like, yeah, this passenger's a racist.
Racist, yeah.
And they should...
But I don't think that's the whole...
Well, the other... They interviewed... Some news stories that I was reading, I'll say I don't know if these were, like, biased or whatever, right. But I was reading some stuff, and they were like, the other passengers were like, well, the guy would, like, stand up, he would yell something, and, like, raise his fist and then sit down because no one reacted, and then do that a couple times. Yeah, and then people were like, okay, I just don't understand what he's doing. And
I feel like if anybody yelled that at any time, that would make me uncomfortable.
Right.
Like,
right.
I was on a plane... to the bowl trip. I was in Charlotte and we were going to Memphis and some dude got a boarding pass printed. And it didn't have the right name. They printed the wrong name. He got his flight switched to this flight. And then his name was like Brian Williams. It was like Brian Williams, legitimately Brian Williams or something like that. But he printed it as like Brian Jeffries or something weird like that. Right. And so they technically didn't have a ticket for him because they printed out the wrong last name. And he was on the flight and he like needed that flight and he like would not get off the plane and they like needed him to get off the plane. And it like, I was getting uncomfortable. I was sitting right next to him, like across the aisle from him. And like, he was being so adamant and he was like, no, I need to be on this plane. Like blah, blah, blah. And I was like, dude, just get off the plane. Like, these people do not mess around. So then he finally got off the plane. You could hear him like yelling like all the way down the like little wing thing. And then they like printed in the right ticket and got back on. But I was like still uncomfortable.
I feel like staying cool will solve so many more problems.
But like, even though like he had a reason to be upset that they messed up, the fact right. that he like freaked out on a plane automatically like made me very wary of him, like even though he was on the plane after that.
Well, I feel like if you're on a plane, you can't like, if you're in a public space, you can like move away, but you're on yeah. a plane, you're like in this like,
I mean,
you're stuck
6x7x7 you, you know, 27,000 feet. Like, like come on, man. But like, he just played Dungeons and Dragons on the
what?
I guess that explains it.
He had a tournament.
Like, you know, Brian, man, chill out. But it just made me uncomfortable with the whole plane ride, just because he freaked out like before the plane took off.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's like any sort of.
I mean, I will say Ben and I now have experience of jumping out of planes.
It's true. It's like, I mean, yeah, I'll say that's like maybe the one thing we have over.
We have an escape plan.
We know what to do. Actually, a parachute.
I'll say, and I don't know if you can wear a parachute onto a plane. I
feel like that would also raise some
a
questions.
Lot of flags.
Like, sir, is that a parachute?
I feel like. Would you be able to open the door if it's going that fast? I feel like
I think it no, would no, they keep have it. To.
In movies, it happens all the time.
Oh, wait,
but
there
like,
we go.
So
we have our
clearly.
Answer.
I'm sure that, no, the fire escape, they have to, right? They, like, I don't think the fire escapes are just for when you're landing, right? Or I guess if you're going down, this is pretty morbid, but if you're going down, like, are people trying to jump off the plane? I feel like people
I
just
feel
try
like if you're
like,
if you're going down, like, jumping off the plane
doesn't help you at all.
Yeah, it's like just going down with it. Would
right,
be.
Unless you have a parachute.
I thought it was like, I thought the doors weren't exactly like car doors. I thought they were a little bit more mechanical.
No, yeah, I think they are mechanical. I
think so, like, so
you think they
would force
open.
Their way open.
Yeah,
I think as soon as you opened it, I think
it like blows
off.
That's
yeah.
true. Okay, it, yeah, I can see that. That might just be
no,
me.
They actually have parachutes under the seats, right? Or no, they're not parachutes.
No, they're life jackets.
Flotation devices.
You can use it as a parachute, but we'll see how that works.
Straight down.
But yeah,
can you bring a parachute? I'm really curious if you can. Bring
I would
a
not.
I would
that.
No.
I just,
I'm not saying like when I have a parachute to that I would bring it onto a plane.
You can wear a Red Bull jacket though, and so then you can pair those stories together.
There you go.
You need Red a parachute.
Bull. Red Bull. I want to do that. Can you make a challenge? I don't think they're doing it this year. But
I'm saying there's these two girls that go to the Panera I work at all the time, and every
this,
time
this
hold
is completely
on
different
this,
from
this,
the Red Bull challenge.
It comes around. It comes around. They always wear they're swagged out in Red Bull gear all the time, and like I do delivery, so I'm constantly going in and out to the parking lot and stuff. And then I see their car, and it's
is
like
a Red Bull car.
Yeah, it's a Red Bull car with a can of Red Bull on
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what are these people doing?
They're
like
just, they're those Red Bull reps, I believe.
Yeah, they give out free Red Bull. But the thing is, like, I get like heart palpitations if I drink Red Bull. if I go on like late night drives or something like that, if I'm like making a car trip, I'll have a Red Bull like, you know, in the back seat just in case I like fall asleep and I can just take a sip and be like, oh my gosh, like let's go. But like It's terrible. I'm not a huge Red Bull guy.
I'll say if you want to make a team, I know one person who wants to be on your team, and that's Diego.
It's true. Thanks,
Ben.
I'll also be on your team. No, I would love to do the Can You Make It challenge. That sounds like such
my
a
buddies
cool
did that.
I know. That's why it make once more. That's just another those people. Those people are also people we need to have.
No, yeah, my friend there. He's a really good photographer.
So if you're saying, if we come down to Georgia, how many people can we get on the pod?
Everyone.
In Georgia. All right.
Literally everybody in Georgia.
It's going to be like another app trip.
I know. We've talked about we'll do like 4 podcasts in a day.
Come to Georgia.
We have to get you and Frank together on one. Yeah. Just Frank. I don't care.
Frank and I have always talked about starting a podcast. And I think like if we got him on this podcast or like you guys got him on this podcast, like it'd be like the Kickstarter.
See, I just want to get Frank's number. Just want to get cool with Frank so that when he gets famous, I can text him and be like, hey, come back on the podcast.
He's doing big things, man. I promise. He's
famous. Why even worried about getting a job? Frank will pull you. He'll pull you to the startup.
Rely entirely on you.
Hey, it's just like you're wrapping up.
So like I haven't gone to class the past 2 years because I've been relying on you to get me a job. So
how are we doing on the job search?
You want to come through?
Anytime you're ready to stop sitting on your butt and get us a job, I'm ready.
No, but yeah, definitely come to Athens. There's literally like always space.
Yeah, we'll plan a trip for sure.
Definitely should.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. But I think that's gonna do it because this podcast went longer than I had thought. That's been like an hour and 10 minutes or something like that.
So. Special edition 2.5 hour long podcast.
I feel like we could
24 hour full day podcast.
We can try it one time. I know Diego had some stories, and I'm sorry we didn't get to them.
It's okay.
That just means that we gotta bring Neil back once more. Because Neil's always so fun. Wonderful guest to have on.
Always doing Neil. Things, Neil.
I know. Where can they find you, Neil? Pimp out all your stuff.
Oh man. Well, you can follow me on Instagram at Neil Neill_Peterson.
It's two L's
because one L is taken, which I'm kind of mad about.
So you're gonna buy his account?
So yeah, I wish. So if you want to follow me on Instagram, if you want to follow me on Twitter, you can. It's like the same thing, but I honestly just like retweet SportsCenter. So like, just go follow SportsCenter. It's like not that interesting.
But if you're not following SportsCenter on Twitter, do you really have a Twitter?
Honestly though, but and then Georgia Football on Vimeo. If you want to see the stuff that I made this fall. If you don't, that's completely understandable.
Is the theme for next year's? Have you started on that? Is that under wraps still? Can you release anything about that?
So we've gone with a very grunge look.
Okay.
This year, so I think we're gonna do very clean next year.
Okay. So I know this year was Autumn Fire. Autumn Fire is done.
We're gonna do Spring Smoke. No, I'm just kidding. No, we don't really have much planned. I should probably get on that. So, thanks a lot, man. No, I'm kidding. But yeah, so. That's good. I'm excited.
Yeah.
So, Diego, can you just pimp us out a little bit?
Yeah. So, if you want to follow the podcast, you can follow us on Twitter, iTunes, Facebook.
YouTube. You can't follow us on YouTube, but you can subscribe.
Right, yeah.
There's five of us.
At Epoch Podcast, Epoch Podcast, all one word. And you can go to our website, where is probably our most consistent place of posting.
True.
We're working on some things there. At epochhq.com, epochq.com. Make sure to rate the podcast. It really helps the podcast grow on iTunes. And that'll do it,
Remember
I think.
That our schedule for posting is every Tuesday and Saturday at 10 a.m. And although we are recording this one a little late because there's no podcast for Tuesday, January 3rd at 10 a.m., it will be out today probably if I can get this rendered on time.
Also, I'd just like to say, I just looked up his website and it's awesome. So go look at it.
All pictures from Yellowstone.
It's true. So. Yeah, it's pretty clean.
Absolutely.
I don't want to take complete credit for all of the pictures that are on there, but I want to take credit for all of them.
I took all of those pictures when
this
I went to Yellowstone.
So cool. Oh my gosh, I love this one. Okay. I'm
debatable.
Done.
So today we're going to go out because we talked about the Arctic visual vibes. Thank you, Mr. Brim Brown, for introducing me to
Sex and Doodles.
Quick musical Doodles and Sex by 2 Feet.
That's what I said.
Just because this song's pretty awesome. But still going to talk over it because I'm not really sure about the copyright stuff with it. So I'm just going to...
I mean, if you want to hear the song again...
Wait, yeah. am I to practice being like a hype man right now? Yeah. Like, yo, what is it? We got Ben in the house.
Just the worst hype team of all time.
Oh my gosh, wait, what's the song called?
Quick Musical Doodles and Sex by 2 Feet.
I enjoy this immensely.
Yeah.
This is why we were saying that the Ben Brown, Mr. Ben Brown Arctic Visual Vibes was a good one.
Oh,
this is a song from
it. This is a song from it, yeah.
Would you look at that?
I mean, Two Feet, a lot of his beats are just so good.
Yeah, he has some good stuff.
Is he on Spotify?
Yeah, I believe so.